Good evening, everyone. Time for another member update. This is the Bitcoin chart, the one day daily chart. Goes back to the beginning of 2015. You can see we had two touch points low, about 162. And you can see the pennant formation is very, very textbook. I've drawn a couple of support lines, one from the bottom spike. This is Bitfinex, and because it's a futures driven market where there's actually, you have the ability to short Bitcoin, the price spike on Bitfinex was a lot lower during that sell-off in August. I think the actual price on Coinbase barely crossed 200, if it even reached that. So I've drawn a trend, another higher trend line, but you can see, regardless of where you draw the lines, the pennant is very, very strong. The top of the pennant is about 475 or about 460. And Bitcoin is looking very, very strong here. It's a long-term thing. You can see it now on the three-day chart that goes back to 2014, and we have that 1175 price spike. But I'm fully convinced, I'm almost positive that we're going to see a breakout to the upside from this pennant. I could be wrong, and it could correct, and this thing could be extended out, but it's looking very, very strong, looking like we're going to get that breakout. Now, I wanted to cover the news coming out of Central State Pension Fund, because the promises are starting to break down. Before I do that, I want to play some of this interview with Jeff Berwick. It's a fantastic interview. He does a really good job of fleshing out, explaining Bitcoin, and I was really impressed by it, so I wanted to play that. Now, the question begins with this gentleman from T-Long of Financial Repression Authority, very intelligent guy, interviewing Jeff about a lot of things, and he's talking about Bitcoin here, and they're talking about a new coin. I don't remember what it is, RS coin or something like that. It's a coin that the government supposedly is coming out with. And of course, he explains how it's stupid that anybody would use a government coin when they could use a government cryptocurrency, when they could use a real cryptocurrency. That's like if the government said, we're selling gold, we have gold accounts, and you can buy them from us. And, anybody who trusts them, is a sucker, basically. But he does a great job of explaining Bitcoin and why it's such a threat. So I wanted to play that here.
So essentially, they had come up with this plan. This is essentially, I'll give you the sort of the background here. The central banks are incredibly, incredibly worried about Bitcoin. Essentially, what they're trying to do right now is to try to get everyone into the banking system and then try to bring in a worldwide taxation system and essentially a one world government and a one world central bank, and then bring out a one world currency. That is the plan. It's been actually a plan for decades, if not centuries, if not millennia in general. That has generally been the plan of these sort of people, central bankers and the people who control the central banks, which control almost every government on Earth, except for a few. There was only really a few governments who didn't have central banks that were controlled by these same people. Many of them have now been attacked and occupied and destroyed. One of them was Libya. Another one is Syria. That's why they're going after it so hard right now. And another one is Iran. And so that's why Iran is always demonized. But essentially what they're trying to do is, and you're seeing this now with the war on cash, they're trying to get cash out of the system. And because the system is so indebted now, and this was actually planned, they planned to create this system which impoverishes people so much and gets so much of the wealth into the, they say the 1%, people think it's the 1%, it's the 0.0001%. It's a very top financial elite that has all the money, literally trillions of dollars, the Rothschilds and people like them. And they're trying to get, they actually have this plan to essentially collapse the entire system so they can bring in a new system. This has been a long-term plan. It's been for decades and decades. And so now we're reaching near the end of that plan, and they've indebted the entire world so much, including every government. Every government is insolvent with debt if interest rates were to rise at all, because that's why they're trying to keep interest rates. And they've had, the Federal Reserve has kept interest rates essentially at 0% for 8 years now. That is absolutely astonishing, but not surprising, because if they allow interest rates to rise, the U.S. government would very quickly be insolvent with $19 trillion worth of debt. If they allowed the interest rate to rise to 10%, which which would be a very low level if they let it go to its natural level. That'd be almost $2 trillion per year in interest payments alone. Very quickly, the whole game would collapse, and they are trying to put that off a little bit longer, and what they're trying to do is get everyone into the banking system now. So that's why they're putting in things like FATCA, the Foreign Account Tax Compliance Act. That's why every time you go to a bank anywhere in the world, you try to open an account, it's very difficult to do, and if you can, they're going to want to know every detail of your life. It's because it's all going into one central database now, and they want to essentially make it so no one can evade taxes. And in fact, that's what the whole Panama Papers leak was all about, was to try to make it look like all these people are evading taxes, therefore we need more controls, and essentially get everyone into a system where there is no privacy, no one can hide anything. The governments of the world know exactly where every penny you have is, and they control it because it's in the banking system. So that's essentially what the plan is, and they're doing it very quickly now. Now they're trying to do a war on cash. Chase just put limits on ATM withdrawals the other day. You're seeing in Europe a lot of places just trying to get rid of cash completely, including Denmark and Sweden. They're almost cash-free already, getting everyone into the banking system. And then they're going to go even further in negative interest rates and really impoverish and really destroy everything. So that's why they're scared to death of Bitcoin, because if people know about Bitcoin and they start getting into Bitcoin, they cannot control it. The only way that they could control Bitcoin is to turn off the internet or turn off the power, and those are actually options. That's why they keep mentioning the government internet kill switch, because they're considering that an option. If this thing gets too popular and they lose control of the money system, which is what they want, that is number one always to them, is that's how they control the governments and the world, essentially, is by controlling the monetary system. They might even turn off the internet. So it's a very highly dangerous game they're playing, and most people don't even realize it. And so they're incredibly concerned about Bitcoin. So they're always trying to attack Bitcoin.
Jeff, if I can interrupt there just briefly. Sure. Could you just explain what it is that makes Bitcoin, which sits on a platform called blockchain technology, what makes it so incredibly not only powerful but almost impossible to police within a fixed regime, and therefore being peer-to-peer and global, and the only way they can stop it, because my opinion is it could will revolutionize banking and transactions. But could you help explain that a little?
Yeah, absolutely. For people who don't know what Bitcoin is, you probably already stopped watching because you're probably already so confused. But it's quite simple. It's a new internet-based currency to explain it, it's sort of like what Napster was. So 10 years ago or 15 years ago, when people used to share music, there was something called Napster, and the government went after them as well. They don't want anything to be decentralized. They want everything to be in their control. And so essentially with Bitcoin, there is no Bitcoin office. There is no Bitcoin CEO. It is completely decentralized. Bitcoin essentially exists on thousands, if not tens or hundreds of thousands, if not millions of computers around the world. So they'd have to turn off every computer that has any sort of Bitcoin server on it to get rid of Bitcoin, which is almost impossible unless they turn off the internet or turn off the power. And again, that is an option for them.
So as long as there was only two computers operating anywhere in the world that could commute, it would still be alive, right?
Yeah, technically it would. It'd probably be very, very slow. But
so if there was anybody outside the banking system, which would have this system, it would circumvent the banking system. So they got to get it all. They got to get everything in the banking system before they can really implement what they want to implement. And Bitcoin, the technology, destroys that possibility. Is that too simplistic?
No, that's essentially what it is. And so they're very highly concerned about it. Bitcoin could destroy the central banks. And the central banks are one of the worst things ever in human history. People don't even realize it's what's impoverished so many people. Every war has been backed by these central banks. They can't have these wars without the money printing of the central banks. I think it was Rothschild who said, "I care not who makes the laws as long as I control the money." Because once you control the money, if there is governments, and this goes to a whole other topic about should we even have governments? Governments, in my opinion, are an unnecessary evil and the worst thing to ever happen to mankind before central banks. But if you're going to have governments, you want to control the money supply. If you want to control the government, that's what they do. So that's what the Federal Reserve and all central banks do. The governments do not control the big decisions. It's the people behind the scenes who control the money who tell the governments what they want done, and that's been going on for decades.
Why isn't why should people have confidence in Bitcoin or the technology that it's not fraudulent? Because obviously the central banks and regulators say this is you're exposed. You're going to find yourself ripped off, if I can use an expression like that. Why is that actually impossible to happen?
Well, the main reason is because Bitcoin is open source software. So there is no one place, there is no secret code on it. Anyone who wants to can look at the Bitcoin code. And of course, thousands of people have. I'm not a coder myself, but I know many people who I trust. And I say, is there anything in this system that is nefarious or something that can be controlled or anything like that? And they all say no. So I trust them on that. If I really wanted to look into it, I'd become a coder and look into it. But you have a certain level of trust with certain people. But it is open source software, so essentially there's nothing hidden in it, and it is all over the world. It's on so many computers that you can't stop it. So that's the real issue they're having, is how to control it. There is, like I said, there is no Bitcoin CEO. That's how they would normally control things. If there was a person who ran Bitcoin, they would immediately go and arrest that person. You even saw that in Australia. A guy came out a few months ago, and one of many who said he's Satoshi Nakamoto, which is the we believe pseudonym for whoever first created it, and immediately the Australian police went to his house, raided it, and kidnapped him, because these people aren't incredibly smart. Actually, it's kind of funny, they're not technologically super geniuses, the central bankers and all these people, and so they think, okay, oh, that's the guy, we'll go get him, we'll put him in jail, and then it's dead. They don't understand completely, but that's really what they would normally do. If someone was trying to compete with them, they would try to destroy them or arrest the CEO and put them in jail for life, but they can't do that with Bitcoin. There's no office to go to. That's another thing they would do, is go in with SWAT teams and knock down the door and steal all the computers. They can't do that. You can't take a gun and destroy the computers and Bitcoin goes away. So that's why.
A fantastic interview. I encourage you to listen to the rest of it. Great explanation by Jeff Berwick, the guy in Australia, supposedly Satoshi Nakamoto. A lot of people have speculated, is he Satoshi Nakamoto? I don't think he is, but even if he is, the analogy I use is what would happen if they, back in the day, they discovered who invented the printing press, and we know, supposedly history tells us who invented it, but does it really matter? No, because the cat's out of the bag, the horse is out of the barn. And once the knowledge is there, then the market runs away with it. And we can see that with the Bitcoin chart. There are many alternatives. Litecoin is one of my favorites. I have probably just as many Litecoin as I in dollar wise as I do in Bitcoin. But there are, WorldCoin Index shows you there's hundreds and hundreds of cryptocurrencies that do all sorts of things. And so this horse is way, way out of the barn. Kind of like cryptography is way, way out of the barn. Really, their only battle that they can do against it is sort of a kind of mind control, because the technology simply can't be defeated. So let's get over to the Central States story here. This is one that is really important, because this is the Central States Pension Fund. This is the pension fund that was originally the Teamsters Fund, and there were a lot of companies in it. And then what happened was the American industrial capacity has been hollowed out for so long that manufacturing has been destroyed, everything's been destroyed, and the companies that were supporting these workers, many have gone bankrupt, and the Central States Pension Fund ended up being taken over by the PBGC, the Pension Benefit Guarantee Corporation. And so now we're in this ridiculous situation. Let's read a little bit of this, and I'm going to dig deeper and go down the rabbit hole on this one. So this is Zero Hedge's next big bailout. Treasury rejects the CSPF proposal to cut benefits. UPS and roughly 270,000 retired truck drivers, construction workers, and other service workers can breathe a collective sigh of relief for now. As we previously reported, the Central States Pension Fund had submitted a plan to Treasury that, if approved, would have cut member benefits and triggered UPS to take an estimated $3.8 billion charge. As the Wall Street Journal reports, Kenneth Feinberg, who was appointed by the Treasury to review all such applications, rejected the plan presented by the CSPF. Feinberg cited few reasons for his decision. a few reasons for his decision, one being that it imposed cuts in a disproportionate manner. Another was that notifications sent out to participants were too technical to be understood. But namely, Feinberg didn't agree with the assumption that the fund would achieve a 7.5% yearly investment return going forward. Those returns were too optimistic and unreasonable, Feinberg said. You get to breathe again. You get to exhale. Our life was on hold, said Bill Orms, 69-year-old retired truck driver from Akron, Ohio, who would have seen his $2,400 a month pension benefit cut in half if the proposal had been accepted. So that's most people would read that and think, oh, well, thank goodness they put this off. Actually, the reason we're going to see here when we look at the documents, the reason it was put off is because the cuts aren't nearly enough. And just to give you a back of the matchbook comparison here, here are the facts. The fund pays out $2.8 billion in benefits a year. They say it's going to be insolvent within 10 years. It has $16.8 billion in assets against $35 billion in liabilities and has roughly one active worker contributing to the fund for every four retirees who draw from it. That is ridiculous. Now, let's think about this amount of money that they have. This is the current assets of the fund, $16.8 billion. Now, if you're paying out $2.8 billion in benefits a year and you have $16.8 billion, let's just think about what it really should take. Well, it's not that difficult to think about, to figure out, because really you should only assume a 1% return with current interest rates. And assuming that the stock market is topping, we're going to look at the breakdown of how those assets are allocated. But just back of the matchbook, I would say that we need to have 100 times this amount of money to generate 1% a year to be able to be solvent. So that means that this pension fund should have $280 billion of assets to pay out $2.8 billion in benefits a year. And it has $16.8 billion. Now, let me show you how deep this rabbit hole goes. First of all, the person who signed off on this document, if you want to read the document, you can pull it here. It's a PDF. It's on the it's on cspensionrescue.com, and this is the explanation of the three reasons why it was rejected. You can see here, this Kenneth Feinberg says, a review of relevant current economic data clearly demonstrates that refined investment return assumptions that take into account appropriate investment forecast data regarding expected near-term rates of return would be expected to produce material different results. For example, commenters, as well as the plan, used the Horizon Survey of Investment forecast of 29 investment professionals for purposes of comparison. In comparison to the Horizon Survey data, the plan's investment returns assumptions are in excess of the 10-year, 50th, and 70th percentile survey results for every asset class. For the plan's total portfolio, the estimated 10-year rate of return based on 10-year average expected results for the corresponding asset classes in the Horizon Survey is estimated to be 6.43%. So here's the summary here. I'm not going to go into this. You can read the whole thing yourself. Based on the foregoing, Treasury and Feinberg was appointed by the Treasury. We're going to look at this Feinberg character. Based on the foregoing, Treasury has determined that the investment return assumptions are not reasonable, and therefore the proposed suspension does not satisfy the statutory requirement that it be that it reasonably estimate to avoid insolvency. Okay, do you see that? So the plan is rejected, not because, oh, they're being too harsh, they're cutting the pensions too much. No, it's being rejected because it's too optimistic. And what that means is that the cuts are going to have to be larger. Now, let's look at this person. You can see here down at the bottom, this is signed off Kenneth R. Feinberg. Let's take a look at Kenneth R. Feinberg. You're going to be shocked here. Here's his Wikipedia entry. This guy is a who's who of bailouts and scams. That's the only way I can explain it here. I'm going to show you. Kenneth Roy Feinberg is an American attorney specializing in mediation and alternative dispute resolution. Feinberg was appointed special master of the U.S. government's September 11th Victim Fund and special master for the TARP Executive Compensation. He was also involved in BP Deepwater Horizon disaster, General Motors recall. So let's go down here and look at these. These are the things he was involved in. The September 11th Compensation Fund, the Hokie Spirit Memorial Fund, which was for the Virginia Tech shooting. He was involved in the BP oil spill. The Penn State settlement. It was announced in 2012 that Feinberg was hired by Penn State to aid in the settlement of dozens of personal injury claims institution from the stemming from the sex abuse scandal of Jerry Sandusky. Aurora Relief Fund, the Aurora, Colorado movie theater shooting. The One Boston Fund, involved in the Boston Marathon bombings. The Newtown Sandy Hook Community Fund. And then there's General Motors. So this guy is knee-deep in every hoax and scam that it's absolutely amazing. Now, here's another interesting article on this deal here. And this is an article that actually came out in 2010. And this is when Goldman resigned as a fiduciary for the Central States Pension Fund. Goldman Sachs Asset Management resigned as a named fiduciary of the $19.8 billion fund. Remember when we were told here that the fund had $16.8 billion? So back in 2010, it had $19.8 billion. So you can see here, it's draining away fast. The pension fund plans to transfer the 30% of plan assets that Goldman Sachs controlled to Northern Trust Global Advisors, the fund's other named fiduciary, and then move 10% of the plan's assets to passively managed index funds, according to a filing in Chicago. Goldman and Northern each oversaw 30% of the fund's assets in diversified allocations, while Mellon Capital Management managed 20% of the fund in S&P index funds and 20% in Barclays Aggregate Bond Index Fund, a court report said. The fund's allocation as of March 31st, now this is back in 2010, was 69% equity, 27% fixed income, 2% cash, and 2% other, probably not precious metals or Bitcoin. So you can see there, 69% stocks, 27% bonds. You're talking about 80, 96% stocks and bonds. What happens when the stock and bond markets crash? Well, it's gone. The money's gone. It's like the South Park episode. And it's gone. So they're already bleeding. The big story is that the Treasury has rejected this reduction in benefits. But a lot of people are going to say, well, phew, that's a big sigh of relief. But the reality is the reason it was rejected is because it doesn't cut nearly enough, because the projections are very, very optimistic. There's four people paying in, or one person paying in for every four retirees. This thing is finished. These people will be lucky to get 10 cents on the dollar. This guy who has a $2,400 a month benefit is probably going to get $240, unless there is a federal bailout. And that's the title of this, the next big bailout. We're seeing that in Puerto Rico. Now we're seeing it with this pension fund. We're going to be seeing it in Illinois. We're going to be seeing it in New Jersey. We're going to be seeing it in California. This stuff is coming to a head. It's all insolvent. It's promises that can't be paid. So again, back to Bitcoin. The Bitcoin market is rallying right now. We're at about 460. I think we're going to see a breakout to new highs. An excellent summary by Jeff Berwick. This is one of the alternatives that the central bankers do not control. And as more and more of these insolvencies start to be realized, start to be reported on, we're going to see more and more money pile into this and possibly get a big breakout to the upside. And we'll talk to you next time.